Well, my name is Jeff Parker. My family and I, my wife Amber here is sitting in the second to the front row, and our son Jaden just went off with your kids to Children's Church. We hail currently from La Vernia, Texas. Amber and I are originally from a little more west Texas, kind of out towards Abilene, Cisco, Eastland area. You may not be familiar with it. But like I said, I've been the worship and discipleship pastor at First Baptist in La Vernia for about 6 years, a little over 6 years. And last term, I had a class with a man you might know, Dr. Ben Craver. And he and I got to talking, and I shared with him my belief that the Lord will eventually lead me into a pastoral lead pastor position, and he connected me with your church, and I am very pleased to be here with y'all today and to share with you the word that I believe that the Lord has laid on my heart with you. So before one more word comes out of my mouth, if you wouldn't mind praying with me as God hopefully leads us through his word today. Father, we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, thank you. We thank you for this opportunity to gather together as a congregation in your sight. We thank you for the beautiful worship that we got to be a part of this morning. And God, we thank you for the team that so selflessly comes each week and gives of their time. I understand what that's like. And so, Father, we thank you that they come and they lead us in the praises of your glorious name. And so, Lord, as we open up your word now, we ask that we realize that the worship does not finish when the song stops. Our worship continues even through the reading of your word and through the preaching of your word. God, worship is something that we should live and not just do. And so God, as we go through your word today, we do pray that your Holy Spirit rests heavy in this place, and that through your Spirit, that our eyes would be open, that our ears would be open to hear and receive the word, and not just receive and let it stop there, but God, let it transform our hearts even more into the likeness of your Son, Jesus Christ, so that, Lord, in this community and wherever we find ourselves, that your Son will be seen in us, and that that will impact others as we meet them, as we go about our daily lives. We pray all this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. If you will open up your books, your Bibles, to Job chapter 19, we're going to use verses 23 through 27 kind of as our source text, but we're really going to be moving through most of chapter 19 today as we read God's word, and then we'll probably be going, if you want to put your finger on Job chapter 1, I want to kind of give you a little context of Job today as well, but we'll start right now with Job chapter 19, verse 23. And Job's speaking here. He says, "Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. Oh, that with an iron pen and lead they were engraved in the rock forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself. And my eyes shall behold and not another. My heart faints within me." So now, like I said, before we really get into the passage, I kind of want to give some context of Job. So we're going to spend a little time in Job chapter 1. I don't like to make a guess on where everyone is and understanding and reading their Bible. I don't know y'all. Y'all don't know me. And so we're going to take a little time, like I said, just to kind of give some backstory of what's happened up until chapter 19. So Job is stated as a rich and righteous man. He's from a country called Uz, which is believed to be southeast of Israel. They're not sure exactly. There's a lot of things that we're not sure about the writing of the book of Job, and that's okay because it's in God's word, and so we trust God's word. Amen? So we don't know exactly where Uz was, but it is believed to have been southeast of Israel. We also are not really given any historical context for when Job actually happened, but the consensus among scholars is that it took place sometime when the patriarchs were coming on the scene. So Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, that's when they really believe that the actual events took place. Now, the dating of the book, when it was actually written, is kind of confusing as well. But again, scholars think because of some of the words that were used and because of some of the terms that we find that are frequent throughout the book, that it may have been written during the exile period when the Assyrians came into Israel and took them off to Assyria and then the Babylonians and whatnot during that time or even after the exile. We find in Ezekiel that he references Job among Noah and Daniel as examples of virtue. So Job is actually put up with Daniel and Noah as examples of virtue. And in the book of Job, Job is actually described as a blameless and upright man. Now if you'll switch to the next slide for me, I kind of want to give you an idea. So it basically comes in and says that Job is a blameless and upright man, and then it begins to rattle off everything that Job has that God has blessed him with. So he has 7 sons and 3 daughters, so 10 children in all. He has 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, very many servants, and that he is known as the greatest of all the people in the East. You can go ahead and switch the slide, brother. Now, whenever we find Job, like I said, at the first of the chapter in chapter 1, we hear kind of about who Job is. And then automatically, then, in just a few verses later, we're transported to God's throne room. And we see that this is the day that it says that the sons of God have come to present themselves before the Lord. And so what we think that this is just an angelic host of beings that have come to give reports over whatever God has delegated them to be over. But at this point, we see that Satan, for some reason, has decided to tag along that day. So it says that Satan was roaming around the earth, and what I imagine, that kind of equals the scripture that we hear that Satan is like a prowling lion roaming around seeing whom he may devour. I think he was just walking around the earth seeing who he can accuse, who he can consume. And so he's looking for somebody to accuse, and God recommends Job. And Satan argues with God that the only reason that Job is a blameless and upright man is because God has blessed him so much, and that's the only reason that he fears God, and so because of the extent of which God has blessed him. So God agrees to let Satan test Job 2 times. The first time, he says, okay, you can do whatever you want to his stuff, but you can't make him sick. And then so Satan goes off and does that, and some things happen. We'll cover that in just a little bit. And then Satan comes back, and the same thing repeats himself. The sons of God are reporting to God. The sons of God are reporting to God, and Satan comes along, and God says, "Have you considered my servant Job?" And Satan gives the same argument. So God says, "Okay, you can reach out and touch his physical person, but you can't kill him." So then I want to go back and hit where Job loses everything. So Satan reaches out his hand, and then all of a sudden, just one right after another, Job begins to lose everything that he has. It says that a servant comes up, and all of a sudden, he's the only one that lived. This group called the Sabians had come out of nowhere and killed all of his servants that were just out in the field doing some work for Job, killed every single one of them except this one guy that they let go so that there was one alive that he could report what happened. And then another servant comes up and says, all your servants were out in the field with your sheep, and this fire came from heaven and consumed and killed all of your sheep and all of your servants, and I was the only one to escape to tell you the story. And then all of his camels were killed by a Chaldean raid, and the servants too. And again, another servant was at least able to escape and come and tell him. And then another servant comes along, and you just see, can you imagine? It's like the worst day you've ever had. And some of us may not have lost this much, but we just feel like one thing comes on top of another. And finally, to just, you know, the last kick in the gut, the last nail in the coffin for Job in this situation, for losing things, a servant comes up and says that a great wind came and knocked down one of his houses, and that wasn't even the worst of it. All of his 10 children were inside having a party when that happened, and the house fell on them and killed them, which is terrible. A parent should never lose their child. That's what we always say, right? But yet it happens so much. And then, during the second part, Satan comes on the scene again and stretches out his hand and begins to strike Job with an illness where sores and boils begin to break out all over his body. And it's so bad that he grabs this broken shard of pottery and begins to scratch because it itches so badly. And then his wife comes up, and to add insult to injury, she says this. Next slide, please. But he said to her, "You speak as one of the foolish women would speak. Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil?" Now, this is a key part in all this. Job did not sin with his lips. Job did not sin with his lips. And now, just a little free advice, guys. Job was measured in his response to his wife, but I would not advise using this as any kind of argumentation with your wife, because it will not go well with you. I mean, you know, it may sound a little better. I'm not saying directly that you're one of these people, but you're acting like them. It's still not good. So I would just advise keeping that out of your argumentation. Love your wife. Love your wife. Don't argue with her. See, thank you, brother. So then all of a sudden, a little time passes. We don't know exactly. They think it's probably a few months that Job is just sitting in the dirt. He has rent his clothes. He has put sackcloth and ashes on himself. He's been mourning for a long time. And then three friends show up on the scene: Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. And then at some point it says a young man comes in named Elihu, but we don't really have time to cover him. But if you get a chance to go and read what Elihu says, it all leads into when God comes in on the scene later on. It's really good. But these friends come in and they sit down with Job. And they do the right thing. They see their friend in his pain. They see him in his misery. And they say nothing. They say nothing. They just have pity on their friend, and they come and they sit down with him. And it says they sat 7 days, but what that really means, we don't know exactly. It means that they sat, as we know, the number seven hopefully is the number of perfection, the number of completion. They sat a complete amount of time, the proper amount of time, to sit with their friend and mourn with him over all the things that he lost. However, they should have probably just kept their mouths shut. Because all of a sudden, Job, after he's dealt with everything that he feels that he can deal with, he begins to open up. And he kind of begins to blame God, saying that God is unfair. And he's like all the rest of us would be at this time. We would be on an emotional roller coaster if we'd lost all this, would we not? And so he's, one moment he's praising God for who he is and his faithfulness, and the next moment he's on the other side and he's blaming God and saying that he's unjust and he's unfair. Why? I've done nothing wrong. Why have you brought all this on me? But see, the problem is, after Job begins to say these things, his friends say, "Well, you know, you must have done something wrong to incur God's wrath on you like this. You must have stepped out of line in some way. So all you need to do is figure out what you've done wrong. Confess your sin. It's so easy." But Job is adamant in his righteousness that he has done nothing wrong. He actually, multiple times throughout the scripture, go ahead and go to the next slide if you would please. These are three of just many, many times that he defends his self-righteousness. He says, "Teach me and I will be silent. Make me understand how I have gone astray. Are your days as the days of man, or your years as a man's years, that you seek out my iniquity and search for my sin, although you know that I am not guilty and there is none to deliver out of your hand?" And then he says, "Behold, I have prepared my case. I know that I shall be in the right." Now, as I said earlier, the book starts out and says that Job is a blameless and upright man, right? You can move to the next slide, brother. In verse 1, it says, "There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil." Now, these words, blameless and upright, God's word could have just said, "Well, he's blameless." You know, the book, whoever was writing it could have just said, "Well, he's blameless," and we get the point. He could have said he was just upright, and we get the point. But no, he's blameless and upright. So that's emphasizing the upright, righteous nature of Job, and that he was one, because he was blameless and upright, he feared God and he turned away from evil. Now, However, as good Baptists, and more importantly, as Bible-believing Christians, we should know that all have fallen short of the glory of God, right? That there are none righteous, not one. So what does it mean that Job was blameless and upright? So verses 4 and 5 in chapter 1, if you want to turn there, you don't have to. I'll have most of the scriptures up today, contain some clues as to what it means that he was blameless and upright. So starting in verse 4, it says, his sons used to go and hold a feast in the house of each one on his day, and they would send an invite to their three sisters to eat and drink with them. And when the days of the feast had run their course, Job would send and consecrate them. And he would rise early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus Job did continually. So we're given five things in this passage of scripture that shows us how Job was blameless and upright before God. If you'll go to the, I think I have a slide for this, yeah. Job offered sacrifices to God, so he realized that sin is something that separates us from God. So, and he knew that a sacrifice, a blood sacrifice, is something that in the Old Testament God required, even before Moses, because we saw many of the pre-patriarch men give, Cain and Abel started off, you know, giving sacrifices. So we obviously blood sacrifices was something that God had instituted and told his people to do to have a relationship even before Moses. So Job offered sacrifices to God. He was concerned with the spiritual welfare of his children. And we see this because he feared the Lord since he was concerned about his sons and daughters cursing God. He was sensitive even towards unknown sin because he wasn't making sacrifices because his sons had cursed. He was making sacrifices in case his sons cursed, in case they messed up. So he was sensitive to unknown sin. And he lived in this attitude continually. So in context, Job was not a sinless man. However, he was blameless and upright in that he was a man of integrity who trusted God as his redeemer, sincerely worshiped God, loved his family, and was consistent in his walk with God. Now, again, this doesn't mean that Job was perfect in and of himself, but he knew what he had to do in regard to the pre-Mosaic law to be in fellowship with God, such as making sacrifices for himself and his family. You see, at first, Job bore his calamities with amazing submission. His blameless and upright nature held on for a good little while. He said, the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Shall we receive good at the hand of the Lord and shall we not receive evil? But as his misery drug out over the months, Job wavered in his confidence that God was for him in defending himself against the bad theology of Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar because they had come and began to say, well, God is this, God is like this, and so we must respond in this way. And because God is this way and that way, we've all heard those guys, right? The armchair theologians that think that they need to come in and give us a whole bunch of platitudes whenever we're going through something, when we're suffering. Perhaps we've even been one. I'll raise my hand. Unfortunately, I'm sure I've been there myself. But he listened to their bad theology and it began to weigh on him. They weren't supporting him in his suffering. They were chastising him in his suffering. And so the things he said about God were not true. He began to insist on his own righteousness at the expense of God's justice. For example, in 13:24 through 23, he said, make me know my transgression and my sin. Why do you hide your face from me? This is to God. Why do you hide your face and count me as your enemy? Job could only think that God was ignoring his faithfulness and treating him as an enemy. Now, even though he gave into his suffering and blamed God for putting him through all of this, he held to one truth that I believe carried him through his trials, and we see this in verse 25 of chapter 19. The truth is that he knew that his Redeemer lives. So the question we need to ask ourselves today is that do we truly know, no matter the circumstance, that our Redeemer lives? In relation to this question, I have four sub-questions. You can tell that I'm in college, right? I have four sub-questions that I want us to ask ourselves this morning. The first question is, next slide, please. In the midst of accusations, do we know that our Redeemer lives? If you look at chapter 19, verse 1, I'm going to break up, as we lead up to our source text, four sections of Scripture and the different things that we need to realize that Christ is our Redeemer through. So in the midst of accusations, do we know our Redeemer lives? Verse 1 through 6 says, "Then Job answered and said, 'How long will you torment me and break me in pieces with words? These 10 times you have cast reproach upon me.'" So these are to his three friends. "Are you not ashamed to wrong me? And even if it be true that I have erred, my error remains with myself. If indeed you magnify yourselves against me and make my disgrace an argument against me, know that then God has put me in the wrong and closed his net about me." So here Job puts it to his accusers that what business is it of theirs to come to him and accuse him and chastise him for a sin that he might or might not have committed? They don't know. They didn't see. How do they know whether he did something wrong or not? And instead of loving him and seeing him through the pain, they have accused him of committing an unknown sin 10 times over without showing any shame for bringing more reproach upon him in the middle of his suffering. See, this is why we need to handle any issue with a friend or family member or even a lost person with gentleness and care. No matter where they are, if they're a brother and sister in Christ or if they are lost as lost can be, we still need to show love and mercy through their pain the same way that Jesus would. Now, I would say, yes, sometimes people need to be spoken with in tough love, but there's a time for that. And we need to trust the Holy Spirit to give us the discernment when that needs to happen. As Paul says in Galatians 6:1, "Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted." Job asks his friends to realize that if he has done something wrong, then to see that God himself is punishing him for it, and they need not add to his misery. So whenever we have people accusing us of things that we know that we did not do, the first thing that we need to ask ourselves, we need to humble ourselves and say, "Lord, be there any sin in me? Look at myself." Before you start pointing your fingers back, that will reflect that in that moment that you know that your Redeemer lives. Because the reason we can look at ourselves in those moments is that we understand that Christ took every single thing, every accusation that we could ever have hurled at us on the cross. So through the accusations, do we know that our Redeemer lives? The second question, in the midst of testing, do we know? Verse 7, he says, "Behold, I cry out violence, but I am not answered. I call for help, but there is no justice. He has walled up my way so that I cannot pass. He has set darkness upon my paths. He has stripped from me my glory and taken the crown from my head." Whoa, this is pretty big stuff, right? Making some real big accusations. "He breaks me down on every side, and I am gone. And my hope has he pulled up like a tree. He kindled his wrath against me and counts me as his adversary. His troops come on together." That's pretty strong words. Job feels as though God has counted him as his enemy. And is this not another true example of how we feel when we're going through a trial? We could feel, if we're not trusting in Christ as our Redeemer, it's so easy to feel that God is against us. When if we look back at the first chapter, is God against Job? Has God come to accuse Job? No, Satan is the one who has come to accuse Job. God is saying, "Look at my servant Job. He is a blameless and upright man." And God knew in his heart that Job could take this. Even if Job wasn't taking it the best way that he could, he knew that Job could take it for his good and for God's glory. When we feel that the world is crashing down around us, we have to remember that this momentary thing will not last forever. Let's not forget Paul's words in 2 Corinthians 4:17, that this light and momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. We must allow the understanding to remain in our hearts and our minds that one day this will all pass and that Jesus is coming back to make all things new. So in the trial, do we remember this and know that our Redeemer lives? Question number three, in the midst of abandonment, do we know that our Redeemer lives? He has put my brothers far from me. This is verse 13. And those who knew me are wholly estranged from me. My relatives have failed me. My close friends have forgotten me. The guests in my house and my maidservants count me as a stranger. I have become a foreigner in their eyes. I call to my servant, but he gives me no answer. I must plead with him in my mouth for mercy. My breath is strange to my wife, and I am a stench to the children of my own mother. Even young children despise me when I rise. They talk against me. All my intimate friends abhor me, and those whom I loved have turned against me. Here, Job tells his three friends that all of his family have abandoned him, and his friends have forgotten him. And what I think, because we see he has three friends there, right? But what I think he means is that there are obviously other friends. Only three friends show up. You go through the worst thing that has ever happened to you. Only three people show up. You're going to feel pretty much abandoned, especially if your family's run off on you. And then what I also think is that the friends that are there with him have forgotten who Job was. They see their friend in his misery. They see him in his suffering, and they think, as many of the Old Testament people did, that if someone sinned, then they're going to be cursed, and so Job must have done something wrong. They make an assumption. But they've forgotten who Job was before. And any memory of who he was before, they've lost. He's lost so much and became ill. He then goes on to list off how the servants and siblings dare not come near him anymore, and that the three friends that have come to mourn with him are showing nothing but disdain toward him. And again, this is why it's so important that when we go through suffering or we're with friends or family who are going through suffering, again, that we show the love and compassion that Jesus has shown us and not pass judgment upon them and not try to pile more guilt and suffering on them than they're already going through. And it's so easy during these times for us, if we're going through it, to feel cut off and abandoned. And so we as Christians should remember again who our Redeemer lives, and that God will, we must know that one day, whatever, however long it takes, that this thing will pass. And question number four, and final question is, in the midst of physical illness and suffering, do we know that our Redeemer lives? Job says in verse 20, my bones stick to my skin and to my flesh, and I have escaped by the skin of my teeth. There's a woman that we knew in Lavernia who passed away, I believe a couple years ago now. Her name was Gail Friesenhahn. Right before we got there, she was a kindergarten teacher in our Sunday school program. She was a mother of multiple children and grandchildren, and a loving and doting wife to her husband, Keith. However, right before we got there, she contracted a type of brain cancer. And within 6 months, she was wheelchair bound and bedridden. If she got out of bed, she had to be wheeled around. But she was faithful, faithful. More than anyone I've ever seen to be at church as much as she could. And she was there almost every week for a good long while as she battled this. Now, I can't say personally, because I don't know if Gail didn't have a moment of doubt. More than likely she did, because she was so sick. And I'm sure there were times that she pleaded with God and that she struggled with doubting God's goodness because she was going through this. But I can tell you that from her family that watched her deteriorate and from all of her friends and church family around her, we never saw her with a poor attitude or something less than that was glorifying God. Every time you saw her, it was, how are you? What can I pray for you about? She was the picture of suffering well, of going through the time of trial, of illness and sickness, and she did it as best as anybody that I could ever see. And we have seen numerous. There's a couple right now, the Herreras, that I just went and visited this last week, and the wife, Alice, is bedridden and cannot come to church. And we went to encourage her and her husband Hank, the whole time. Alice is sick in a hospital bed. in her house, but she's smiling. She can barely talk. She's, I believe it's called intubated. She can barely talk, but she's laying there and smiling the whole time. How are you? And these are great pictures. And again, I'm not saying that these people have arrived and that they have no moment of doubt, but they are great pictures of what it is to live through these difficult times. And the reason they know it is because they know that their Redeemer lives. You see, Job had lost everything and had an illness that made him wish he had never been born. But in verse 25, he comes around and he states that my Redeemer lives. And so, go to the next slide, please. In Hebrew, the word that we see here, and it's actually the word that's mostly used for the word Redeemer throughout the Old Testament, is the Hebrew word goel. And that means kinsman redeemer. And what kinsman redeemer means, it refers to a family member who has both the right and the responsibility to vindicate any member of the family that is in trouble. We see this in Ruth 4, verses 1 through 6, where Boaz comes in and says that he will marry Ruth and rescue her and Naomi out of poverty and out of having to just go along and pick up the leftovers after they're taking care of the wheat fields. He comes in and he takes her out of her situation and rescues her. And he's a family member, as we know and we find out. And they end up being in the lineage of Jesus, right? And then we see it again in Exodus 6:5 and Isaiah 43:14 and 44:6 says God redeems Israel from slavery and from neighboring enemy nations and even from themselves. And in Genesis 48:16, God is Abraham's individual redeemer and also our individual redeemer. And in Psalm 19:14 conveys the idea that the redeemer is not only one who rescues, but one who protects. So ultimately, Job's proclamation in verse 25 says that even though God is the one who has allowed the catastrophe to come into his life, even though he has these moments where he's doubting, where he is railing to the heavens, where he's shaking his fist at God, that even though this catastrophe has come into his life, he still has hope that God will be the one to vindicate him, whether it be in life or in death. So while Job was blameless and upright in the sight of God, this does not mean that he was without sin, again, and that he had no room for growth. God saw this. This is an opportunity for Job to grow closer to me, because the suffering he experienced revealed in him self-righteousness and ultimately his need for God. At this point, the one thing that Job had going for him was his understanding that his Redeemer lived and that God was his Redeemer. As we said earlier, Job is seen as one of the most venerable men in the Old Testament. And while we can look to Job as an example in how he truly desired to please God and he was a blameless and upright man, just like any of the great heroes of the Old Testament, he is only a foreshadowing of Jesus, the Messiah. Next slide, please. There's a pastor named Tim Keller, and he has this quote. And I hope you'll forgive me for using the S word in church. But it's not that bad, trust me. Tim Keller says this: Jesus is the true and better Redeemer, a true and better Job, the truly innocent sufferer who then intercedes for and saves his stupid friends. Right? Is that not right? These men are foolish. They come and they begin to spout out things that they don't even understand. But Jesus is the true and better Job, and the truly innocent sufferer who then intercedes for and saves his stupid friends. In fact, the reason we can see that Jesus is again a picture of Jesus, or that Job is a picture of Jesus, we can look back at the words of Job in verses 23 and 24 in verse 19. I think, yes. It says this: "Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. Oh, that with an iron pen and lead they were engraved in the rock forever." So Job's wish did come true. However, his story, he wished that his story would be engraved in the rock and told forever. His story is just one part of God's word that points to the one that came that is greater than Job, greater than Noah, greater than Daniel, greater than David, and even greater than Moses and any other hero of the Old Testament. It is his story, Jesus' story, the story of our amazing God and gracious Redeemer who saved us at a great cost to himself. Job was accused, and though he was a great man in many respects, at the end of the day, he was found lacking and in need of a redeemer. Jesus was accused, and though he was totally innocent of any wrong, and though he was totally innocent of any wrong that he was found doing, he was found guilty so that he could redeem us from our sin and really from ourselves. Job was tested and failed miserably, though God had mercy on him in the end because he repented. Jesus was tested by Satan in the wilderness and won the day because he trusted and depended completely upon his Father. Job was abandoned by his family and friends and left to grovel in the dirt. And though he was tested, he was never abandoned by God. Jesus was abandoned by his family and his friends and even his heavenly Father. We see it in Matthew 27:46, where it says, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, my God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Even God turned away from Jesus on the cross to fulfill prophecy. But his Father turned away him while he was on the cross because he bore the complete weight of the sin of mankind and the fullness of God's wrath for those who would be called his children. Job suffered physically, spiritually, and emotionally through this trial. And while I don't think any of us, again, should ever be hard on him for not maintaining complete trust in the goodness of God, how many of us could say that we could fare any better? But Jesus suffered physically, spiritually, and emotionally more than anyone in the history of mankind. Now, we might be able to argue that the cross, though vile and one of the most horrible types of torture that is ever devised by man, is recorded by history. It is one of the most horrible types of torture ever devised by man in execution. We might be able to say, and then again, that's torture and execution, that someone else somewhere has gone through something that is equal within the physical realm or worse than crucifixion. We might be able to say that in the physical realm. However, Jesus also bore the weight of all of God's wrath and all of our sin. So the combined weight of our sin and the Father's wrath outweighs anything that anybody else has ever gone through in the course of history or ever will. Jesus is the Redeemer, the great and living Redeemer that innocently suffered, interceded for, and offers salvation to any of us if we would simply believe with our heart and confess with our mouth that he is Lord and that God raised him from the dead. We will be saved. There are no ifs, ands, or buts about it. So let's take the story of Job and never forget it, but not for the sake of Job, but for the sake of Jesus to whom it points. Let us never forget, because, next slide please, he is the great high priest who has passed through the heavens. Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are. Yet without sin, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Jesus is the one that fulfilled Job's own words when he said in 13:15, "Though he slay me, I will hope in him. Though God slay me, I will hope in him." The Psalms say that it pleased the Father to crush the Son for our sake. So do we have the same ability to trust God in us today? Have we the same conviction in our hearts to see what God has called us to through to the end, no matter the cost, no matter what comes our way? Can we truly say that we know and can draw near to the throne of grace with confidence in our time of need, which is every second of every hour of every day? If Christ is in you, then you do. Next slide, please. John 1:16 says, "For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace." 2 Peter 1:3 says, "His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness." And Galatians 2:20 says, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." Now, as Hebrews 3:7 through 8 says, "Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion on the day of testing and in the wilderness." While some might see it cruel for God to put Job through all of this suffering, I see it as God's mercy. Many times, suffering in our life is actually God's mercy pressed upon us to say, I am here. Look to me even more. Depend on me even more. Because suffering in the life of the Christian is really God's way to trust, get us to trust and depend on him so that we can grow closer to him. Again, we should see suffering as God's mercy in our lives. You see, the sovereignty of God will not allow us to go through anything we cannot handle if we abide in, trust in, and depend on Jesus and in his death, burial, and resurrection. Through his suffering, he gives us the ability to overcome anything this broken world can throw at us. Is that not a greater testimony than I prayed to God and he gave me $1 million and I got a BMW, a big house? Is that not a greater testimony that God carried us through, that God saw us through? He is the friend who sits with us in the silence until we are ready to listen. Unlike Job's friends. And when we are ready, his counsel is perfect because he has been through it all. There's nothing he hasn't seen, church. Now, right now, we have an opportunity to place our trust in God. You may be thinking, well, Brother Jeff, I do trust in God. And you very well probably do. However, let's not be like Job and make the mistake that he did and think that we've arrived. And that we can trust in our own self-righteousness. Let us take yet another opportunity to draw closer into the presence of Christ. So if today we find ourselves in the place of Job, let us, again, not harden our hearts as in the day of rebellion and trust in our own self-righteousness. Let us take this time as the worship team comes to seek God and remember the words of Job that eventually led him to the place of God, or repentance, and an even deeper walk with God. You see, after Job went through on his tirade and then Elihu comes and he basically kind of heralds God's coming, that God's going to show up on the scene. That's Elihu's job. He points everything kind of back in the right direction. And then God shows up and he doesn't really give Job an answer in the sense that we would think would be a normal answer, a satisfying answer for humans. But he basically says, were you there when I did this? Were you there when I created the seas and I put up the border that said this far and no further that the waves should come? Consider, and he goes through this big long list of all these animals and then he shows, have you considered the Leviathan and the behemoth and how big and great they are? And though they're dangerous and mighty, they're still good. So God gives Job this picture of himself, of how he is great and mighty, and things may come that are terrible in the wake of God's greater plan. However, God will see us through because he knows what's going to happen. He knows how it's all going to end up. God is sovereign and in control. Can we say that we know that our Redeemer lives? Do we know this today? We can and we will. If we would simply place our trust in Jesus, the true and better Job, who innocently suffered and interceded on our behalf in order to save us for our good and for his glory. Let's pray. Father, we just ask right now that you would intercede yet again on our behalf. The great thing about the gospel is that we should never tire of listening to it. We should never tire of hearing how great your son Jesus is and everything that he went through for us. And so today, again, Lord, stir up in us the joy of our salvation and let us draw closer into your presence. And Father, if there be anyone in this place that doesn't know you, that Father, that you would draw them in and let them know that this is a family of faith that they can get plugged into and learn more about you. God, as the worship team plays, we ask that if anyone feels the weight of your drawing on their hearts, no matter what it may be, that they would come and receive prayer. We pray all this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.